888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. Miss me? ReliefActor.com studio. Had some business to take care of. Oh, is that all right with you? Come on. Got so much to cover between now and the close of the program. This is Phone a Bro, Can You Beat Kirk Friday? Oh, you thought we were going to do it? Au contraire, mon frère. In fact, the categories for Can You Beat Kirk will be this week in the news, sports, aviation, the Bible, and pop music of the 2000s, which will be an audio clue. So if you think you're sharp in this week in the news, sports, aviation, the Bible, and pop music of the 2000s, stick around for the final hour. More on that in due course. The House has voted to grant statehood to Washington, D.C. I don't know why people are shocked by that. They told you what they were going to do. And it's just the beginning. Next, Puerto Rico. That way they get four new Democrat senators, forever changing the balance of power. I pointed out when I was on Hannity last night that when we admitted the last two states, Alaska and Hawaii, the idea was that one state was going to be Republican and one state would be Democrat, and they would send a member of the House on each side, and therefore the balance of power in D.C. would not be upset. This is very different. You're talking about, again, four new Democrat senators, likely two new Democrat House members, which is why they want to do it. If, when you admitted Washington, D.C., admitted Puerto Rico, they would more likely vote Republican, and Democrats still wanted to do it because they felt that these people deserve representation, then that would be different. But you and I know what the real deal is. The trial of Derek Chauvin ended in all three counts convicted. Many people were celebrating in the streets after the conviction. I was traveling when I heard that the jury had reached a verdict. It wasn't very long that they deliberated, it doesn't appear. And shortly after the announcement was made that they reached a verdict, the announcement was made. Now, I got a number of phone calls from media people asking me what my opinion was. And I said from the very beginning, this is a trial of an individual officer who allegedly murdered an individual suspect named George Floyd. Nothing more, nothing less. Even in the opening statement, the prosecution made it clear that the Minneapolis Police Department was not on trial. So I don't know why you felt it was on trial. A jury reached a conclusion. I thought the jury saw it the way they saw it, and I don't think they reached an unreasonable verdict. I would hope that had they reached a different verdict, the same people out in the streets would not have been out in the streets rioting and tearing and looting on the grounds that 12 people reasonably saw it differently than you did. Now, I thought that there is an excellent chance that this trial is going to be reversed on appeal because of what Maxine Waters said over the weekend. She all but said that if you don't reach a guilty verdict, there's going to be violence in the streets, and I'm going to be supporting the violence in the streets. Alan Dershowitz even said that was grounds for reversal. The judge said on the record, I'd never seen that. Sidebar on the record, he said, I will concede to you, he said to the defense, that Congresswoman Waters may very well have given you grounds for mistrial on appeal. And I thought what he was going to do was poll the jurors one by one and ask whether or not he or she had heard what Maxine Waters said, and if so, what kind of effect it had on him or her. He didn't do that. I was surprised. And for that reason, also, there might be a reversal on appeal. Also, there was this, I told you about the lead prosecutor that people gushed all over. He made what I thought was a serious mistake near the end of this trial on the rebuttal witness when apparently some tests that had been conducted, they had the results but didn't turn over the results until later on. It had to do with whether or not there was methane in the lungs of George Floyd, and apparently that test had been taken. The defense made some big deal out of that nobody had taken the test, but apparently the test was taken, but the documents weren't dumped on the defense until the final hour. You can't do that. And the judge was bothered by that and said, I'll allow you to ask this very narrow question about that, but nothing beyond that. And as far as I was concerned, the prosecution went too far. The defense jumped up, made an objection, and the judge once again instructed the prosecution on how to question the witness without stepping his bounds. So for those reasons, I also think there might be a very good chance that this trial might be overturned on appeal. And if so, please don't go out in the streets and yell and scream and tear things up. I've mentioned before when Martin Luther King said riots are the language of the unheard. A lot of people on the left quote MLK when he said that. What he also said was that they are self-defeating, socially destructive, and I will continue to tell my brothers and sisters with love that this is not the way. And he said that when a bunch of different people were in charge. There's a piece in NPR, which is left-wing, came out in 2017, headline, "It's not your grandfather's LAPD, and that's a good thing." NPR, 2017, April. And it's about how the LAPD has changed from the one that a woman named Connie Rice, I understand she's some sort of cousin to Condi Rice. Connie Rice is a Harvard-educated civil rights lawyer who sued LAPD year after year after year for violations, alleged violations of civil rights. And the article says the police department in 1992 was largely white, overwhelmingly male, led by Chief Gates, an authoritarian who ruled from the top down, on and on and on. For years before the 1992 riots, Rice says, cops felt comfortable denigrating black and brown people over their radios. When the transcripts of those conversations were introduced in court cases, Rice says they raised the veil on the subterranean culture that LAPD exposed to the black community and to the poor Latino community and any community that they decided wasn't on the right side of the thin blue line, close quote. All about what Connie Rice says. Again, April 26, 2017, it's not your grandfather's LAPD, and that's a good thing. Article says, this is the second paragraph of the article, quote, "I can honestly say that the LAPD of 2017 is not your grandfather's LAPD, and it's not the LAPD of Daryl Gates that 25 years ago plunged this city into the biggest riots in modern American history," says civil rights lawyer Connie Rice. Rice spent a lot of time from late 1980s through the mid-1990s challenging police aggression in the city's communities of color, especially people in poor parts of the city where policing was designed less to protect and serve and more to contain and suppress, end of quote. That was then. And now you have people like Maxine Waters irresponsibly saying things like this?
"I believe that it stems from the history of this country. It stems from slavery, when whites were absolutely in charge and they absolutely controlled the lives of people and their families. If they decided to separate families and send the boys in one direction, the girls in another direction, the mothers to the big house, I mean, they've always been in charge. And I think that this thinking about the need to control, the need to, you know, make sure that people stay in their place, so-called, has been, you know, what has been basically what has happened in America for all of these years. And I think it continues in various ways."
Continues in various ways, honestly. It advances her career. As long as black people are angry, they pull the lever for her. I'm Larry Elder.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
That confirms what we all sort of suspect. America's not in a good place right now. We're just not. I mean, here's a headline you won't see anywhere. Chauvin found guilty. The system worked. No. The progressives don't like that. AOC doesn't approve of that. AOC doesn't approve of that at all. In fact, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez seems very disappointed that Derek Chauvin got the maximum amount of guilt that he could have possibly received at yesterday's trial.
This verdict is not justice. Frankly, I don't even think we call it full accountability because there are multiple officers that were there. It wasn't just Derek Chauvin. And I also don't want this moment to be framed as this system working, because it's not working. And that's what creates a lot of complexity in this moment.
That's a lot of complexity in that, young lady. A lot of complexity in this moment. Justice was not served. In fact, there wasn't even any accountability. And if that wasn't a goofy enough take for you, how about Nancy Pelosi? Nancy Pelosi actually looked up into the heavens and thanked George Floyd for dying.
Thank you, George Floyd.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
You know, you hear a lot of people talk about end of days and whether we are preparing for the raptures. You know, they can be easily forgiven because of all that is happening in our life. This country alone, don't look to the world, but to this country alone, we are watching the American heritage turned upside down. We're watching illegal immigrants given money by a government that denies it to those who are hardworking Americans with families to support. We are looking at a president who wouldn't answer a question, as I said, about packing the Supreme Court. But today, he's creating a commission and doing full everything in his power to move toward another four justices that will dilute the court. It's just one thing after another. And one rational thing that he's done, which is to announce he's bringing home our troops from Afghanistan. That is what President Trump wanted to do years ago and was stymied at every turn by the military-industrial complex.
Yeah, we're not going to mention the neocons and Lindsey Graham because that would be inappropriate. Yeah. Have you been in touch at all? And you don't have to say if you, but I'm wondering if you've been in touch with the president at all.
I've seen him a number of times here. I guess most recently a week or so ago. And he, by the way, sounds great. He sounds
Hey, Larry, I was wondering if that situation with the police shooting of the young lady that was stabbing the other young lady, you know, maybe that scenario would have been a little bit different how the comments said it. Had that been one of Biden's kids or grandkids that were in that position to be stabbed, or Kamala Harris's, hey, how about LeBron's, one of his grandkids or something like that? How would have that gone over? And hey, maybe that cop shouldn't have pulled the trigger then. Maybe he should have just let it happen. How do you think the response would have been? Oh, no. So I'm wondering how that would have come down had it been somebody that was involved with their family and the police officer decided, you know what, let me think about this before I do something. Have a great day, Larry. Take care.
Didn't you hear? Biden's granddaughter called and say, Pop, if that had been a white girl, he would have shot her in the arm.
Yeah, Larry, I don't understand why the incident in Columbus by the white police officer shooting the black girl was considered racist. Wasn't she in the process of killing another black girl? And if he really didn't like black girls and wanted to off some of them, why didn't he let the girl go ahead and stab the other girl? Because after all, she's black, he's white, so he's not, you know, he's not doing an appropriate racist thing by allowing the murder to continue.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. The calls we're referring to, the black teenager who was shot and killed by a Columbus police officer. She was apparently about ready to plunge a knife into at least one person, maybe even two. Even a neighbor said, but for the swift action of this white police officer, there could have been more carnage. But LeBron James, before knowing the facts, tweeted out an emoji and said about this officer, "You're next," presumably referring to the conviction of Derek Chauvin. And then he realized that he got the facts wrong, and maybe, just maybe, the officer was doing his job, and maybe, just maybe, had the officer not been there, had the officer not shot this teenager might have killed another teenager, both of whom, by the way, are black. And then he deleted it, but never apologized. All of that and more, 888-971-SAGE. I am Larry Elder. Now, we've got this petition on my website, LarryElder.com, at the very banner. It has a Stand with Georgia banner referring to the new Georgia election law that has been demonized by people like Joe Biden, that says it's worse than Jim Crow. It's Jim Eagle. So if you think that's a bunch of hooey, please go to my website, LarryElder.com, and sign our petition. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. Let's go to Rick. Rick is in Minneapolis. Rick, thank you very much for calling. How are you, sir?
Hey, Larry. Thank you for having me on. I'm doing okay, I guess, under circumstances, since I'm packing as we speak. I've lived in Minneapolis since 1999, loved the city, lots to do, lots to offer. Great opportunity, but I'm moving. And I want to tell you, I can't hardly even get a U-Haul truck to get out of the city. The biggest truck I can get is a 15-footer because everybody is leaving. And they've been doing this for the last year, but this Marxist, socialist mayor that we have here in Minneapolis, and the governor, they can't put the genie back in the bottle. They'd let the third precinct burn. That's my precinct. I was up during the nights and protecting my neighborhood, and it's just an atrocity what they've done to this city. It was a beautiful, great city, lots of opportunity, but it's time for it to go, and I'm moving to Bella Vista, Arkansas, and I've got to go.
Rick, my next question was going to be, are people leaving the city or are people leaving the state?
Well, I know that they're leaving the city and moving to the rural areas. Mm-hmm. I know that for sure. That's what I was shared with today by, I won't mention the name of the truck and moving truck,
right.
But I can only say that I know that they're moving out of the city. I don't know that they're moving out of the state for sure.
Well, Rick, thank you so much for the call. I really do appreciate that. Please stay in touch with us and let us know about your progress. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. As I mentioned, there was a fight between some black teenage girls, and someone called 911. Neighbor called 911. We're not quite sure who called 911. It might even been the person that was actually shot who called 911. They don't even know yet. But the body cam tape released almost immediately so that people would have the ability to hopefully find out before they react and before anybody really had a chance to react, before he had a chance to find out the facts. LeBron James, who, as I understand, is not playing right now. So it's not like he, you know, in between practices had to sit down and figure out what's going on. This guy had time to figure out the facts. He's got almost 50 million followers on Twitter. For perspective, Barack Obama has 130, something like that. So this guy is not that far back from having the kind of power and clout that Barack Obama has. And how did he use it? By putting out a false narrative right away that this officer did the same thing that Derek Chauvin did, which was to engage in police brutality. And a lot of people feel motivated police brutality. Irresponsible. And I've talked to you about Mr. James before. The man has lived up to his obligations as a father, as a man, married the mother of his children. I've not heard any scandal at all about his personal life. And rather than use his huge platform to encourage other young black men to live by his example, because that is far and away a bigger social problem than the rare instance in which an unarmed black person like George Floyd dies in police custody. And again, the officer was convicted of murder. Three counts. Far bigger problem. Out of all the homicides, 7,000 black homicide victims last year, 25 maybe unarmed blacks, I say maybe because the Washington Post says 18 were shot and killed, unarmed blacks shot and killed by the police. But that's not the only way an unarmed person is killed, obviously. So roughly about 25, the speculation is. So that's 1/3 of 1% of the 7,000 black homicide victims. Now, I saw on Twitter when I said something like that, somebody said, now watch Larry Elder point out how many unarmed whites are killed every year compared to unarmed blacks by the police. And this person put it up sarcastically. My reaction was, you're damn right Larry's going to point that out. It's called perspective, bro. Unbelievable. White guy running on foot, running from a police officer, dashes into somebody's backyard. Officer mistakenly takes the homeowner for the suspect, shoots and kills the homeowner. Not a story because the people involved are white. Idaho, not long ago. Couldn't care less. You're being manipulated. Meanwhile, the New York Times writes that since the Derek Chauvin trial began, the police have killed about more than three people per day. Yeah, and they killed more than three people per day before the Derek Chauvin trial began. And they did last year and the year before last. They've averaged killing about three people per day. You want to talk about how many black homicide victims per day? 19 per day. Per day. 670 since the Derek Chauvin trial has begun. New York Times didn't point that out. I'm Larry Elder.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The Derek Chauvin trial was for many, many people fraught with rage and sadness and resentment, frustration, apprehension. What's going to happen as the verdict is reached? And yesterday, I think everybody was sort of stunned. I was watching the pundits react with amazement that the jury returned a verdict so quickly. And of course, all the analysts, all the smart kids on TV said, that's not good for Derek Chauvin. And as it turned out, it was not good for Derek Chauvin. Guilty, guilty, guilty. And it sort of feels like America collectively let out a sigh of relief. Heard that metaphor a lot, too. You heard that description. And we all know why people were relieved. First of all, millions of Americans legitimately believed that justice was served. But the other reason for the sigh of relief is a little more insidious, a little more nefarious, darker, a little scary. And that is the fact that Americans instinctively knew that if the verdict turned out any other way except guilty, 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 multiple cities would burn.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Burka.
I say this, I am looking at it very seriously, beyond seriously. From a legal standpoint, I don't want to really talk about it yet.
Beyond seriously. I'm looking at it beyond seriously. That was the 45th president of the United States being asked about will he run for the White House again for 2024. Put the mics on, gentlemen, and get the headphones on. I'm going to survey the massive team here. It's going to take at least 3 hours to get all the answers in. This is America First on the Salem Radio Network. What does that mean to you?
Keep
keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Hey, where do you think we are in this country? Where do you think we are, and where do you think we may be going?
We are now with a president who refused to answer the questions straightforwardly as a candidate, who has now made it very clear he's going to make every effort with a high degree, a high probability of success, to pack the Supreme Court of the United States. This is something he avoided throughout the campaign. It was not his finest or most candid moment in his campaign, among, I would say, a number of such moments. So I think, you know, this is just the latest development in altering what is America, our government, and the relationship with the governed. It's clear that there's an effort.
Larry, one consequence of this George Floyd matter is that it appears to have permanently legitimized the use of mob violence against others living in the United States, the common citizenry. This whole thing is very dangerous because setting it as a precedent where every time an African-American suspect is done wrong, this cannot stand.
Hi, Larry. My name's Tom from Concord. I just want to ask the question that you can probably answer the best. If people have the premise that police are incompetent, how can they, with a straight face, turn around and expect them to be trained to shoot the guns out of a criminal's hands or shoot them in the leg rather than using deadly force like they're trained to do? And also, I hope you bring up the narrative that, you know, whether cops are incompetent or not, assume that they are, and assume that your best bet of getting going home safely is following the cops' orders and doing what they say and not giving them a hard time.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. Now, I want to invite you to attend a special and exclusive online event with the U.S. Senator on May the 6th. Learn how to effectively address issues surrounding big tech, cancel culture, and the woke mob. Decades of unchecked data collection has given big tech more targeted control over American lives than any company or government in the world. Addressing that problem, Republican Senator Josh Hawley from Missouri has written a book called The Tyranny of Big Tech, where he argues that these megacorporations pose the gravest threat to American liberty in decades and what we can do about it. He's hosting an online event on May the 6th to discuss the issues surrounding big tech, and you're invited to ask, and you can ask him your special question. It's called Ask Me Anything Event. Take advantage of this exclusive time with a sitting U.S. senator, and you'll get a copy of The Tyranny of Big Tech. This special offer is by invitation only, so go to askahost.com for all the details. Askahost.com for all the details. Askahost.com. The bizarre thing about this woke culture, this anti-police woke culture, never have the scrutiny over police officers been greater. Never has the education of police officers been greater. Never has the diversity in the police department been greater. And once MLK said riots are the language of the unheard, something he said in the 60s, when those conducting the investigations, those making the decision about whether or not the officers are going to be charged, were white, as were the police departments. That has long since no longer been the case. The article I just now quoted about Connie Rice, the civil rights activist who sued the LAPD for decades, came out in 2017. That's 4 years ago. LAPD, she said, is not your grandfather's police department. Minneapolis, the police chief is black and Latino. Baltimore, where Freddie Gray died. We talked about this before. Number one and number two running the police department, black. The state attorney who brought the charges against the six officers, black. Black female. Six of the officers, black. Black judge, before whom two of the officers decided to try the cases, and he found them both not guilty, by the way. All city council Democrats, majority black. 40% of the police department was black. The U.S. attorney at the time, Loretta Lynch, black. And the president of the United States, black. And we're talking about systemic racism, endemic racism, foundational racism. Are you smoking something? When Obama ran, polls found only 3% of Democrats said they would never vote. 3% of Republicans where they say they would never vote for a black person. 4% of Democrats, by the way. I'm sure different polls have different things. This is a prominent poll. In other words, virtually everybody would vote for somebody black if they felt the black person was qualified. First time the question was asked, would you vote for a black president? 1958 Gallup, 37% said yes. 37. 2007, 5% said they would not vote for a black person. So 95%, no problem. And we're told that racism is in our DNA, as Obama said? I mean, how incredibly insulting is that to you? To America? And don't get me started on Eric Holder with his pernicious racism BS. Now, how many years have I been telling you about Relief Factor? 5 years. Some say there might be 100 million folks struggling with some level of pain, whether from exercise or just getting older. Because that can do it, just getting older. You see, the docs who formulated Relief Factor selected four 100% drug-free ingredients, each of which deal with pain from a different metabolic pathway. So if you've got pain, back, shoulder, neck, hip, foot, knee pain, from exercise, or just getting older, consider ordering the 3-week quick start. Still discounted to only $19.95. That is less than a dollar a day to see if we can get you out of pain. Then after that, less than the cost of a cup of coffee a day to stay out of pain. Go to relieffactor.com, 800-500-8384, 800-500-8384. Scott?
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The Derek Chauvin trial was for many, many people fraught with rage and sadness and resentment, frustration, apprehension. What's going to happen as the verdict is reached? And yesterday, I think everybody was sort of stunned. I was watching the pundits react with amazement that the jury returned a verdict so quickly. And of course, all the analysts, all the smart kids on TV said, that's not good for Derek Chauvin. And as it turned out, it was not good for Derek Chauvin. Guilty, guilty, guilty. And it sort of feels like America collectively let out a sigh of relief. Heard that metaphor a lot too. You heard that description. And we all know why people were relieved. First of all, millions of Americans legitimately believed that justice was served. But the other reason for the sigh of relief is a little more insidious, a little more nefarious, darker, a little scary. And that is the fact that Americans instinctively knew that if the verdict turned out any other way except guilty, 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 multiple cities would burn.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Burka.
I say this, I am looking at it very seriously, beyond seriously. From a legal standpoint, I don't want to really talk about it yet.
Beyond seriously. I'm looking at it beyond seriously. That was the 45th President of the United States being asked about will he run for the White House again for 2024. Put the mics on, gentlemen, and get the headphones on. I'm going to survey the massive team here. It's going to take at least 3 hours to get all the answers in. This is America First on the Salem Radio Network. What does that mean to you?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Hey, Larry, I love your show. I actually live around the Columbus, Ohio area. You know, I think we're just too soft on these kids these days. They think that they can just do, say whatever they want and get away with it. And it's just not right. I feel bad for that girl. But, you know, when the police show up, they're now the authority. I pray for her and her family. But unfortunately, until we get these kids under control and start teaching them respect, once again, this is just going to continue to happen. Have a good night, Larry.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. I want to thank Jennifer Horn and Bob France and Mark Eisler for sitting in for me. I really do appreciate it. There's so much to say about all of this. The question is, what do we do about all of this? I don't know anything at all about these teenage girls. I understand the teenager who was shot was a foster child. The foster mom talked about what a wonderful child she was and all of that, but I don't think we know about her family situation. And what do we do about this? It is far and away the bigger problem. You think reparations are going to solve this? You think condemning our infrastructure as racist, as Beto O'Rourke is doing, is going to solve this? You think people like, Mayor Pete, he's the transportation secretary, the one who claims that our infrastructure is built on systemic racism. And Beto O'Rourke, who said that America is, what did he say, foundational, endemically, and systemically, what was it?
This is a violent country that loses more than 40,000 of our fellow Americans every year to gun violence. And this is a country that has been defined by foundational, systemic, endemic racism.
Okay. By the way, it was Mark Davis, not Mark Eisler. Anyway, Mark Eisler and Mark Davis. And for me. Same day, the two Marks? Okay. Foundational, endemic, systemic racism. One of the things that Malcolm X said is that black people's problems can only be solved by black people. It was true then, it's true now. And that book written by Jason Riley, appropriately titled, Please Stop Helping Us. Please stop passing programs that make things worse. Please stop passing laws and bills and things to make it even easier and easier and easier to have a child outside of wedlock, and therefore make it easier and easier and easier for someone to marry the government, and easier and easier and easier for men to abandon their financial and moral responsibilities. Please stop doing that. Please stop passing laws like the minimum wage, which will be a 100% increase, by the way, in the minimum wage, that destroys jobs for unskilled people. And it isn't so much the money. It's the work ethic. It's showing up to work on time. It's learning how to be respectful to customers and to your boss. Learning how to work under a budget. These are the kinds of things that you learn in your first job. And all too often, these kids are not getting this because of these job-killing laws. And how it is that the left can't even see this. When I mentioned Acorn before they disbanded, they came out to California a few years ago, and they wanted to hire people to gather signatures to put a ballot on the, to put a measure on the ballot to increase the minimum wage here in California. Acorn files a brief with the court, I am not making this up, in order to exempt itself from the then existing minimum wage and overtime requirements. And the brief said, quote, the more we must pay each individual worker in minimum wage or overtime, the fewer outreach workers we will be able to hire, end of quote. Please stop helping us. Community Reinvestment Act that ultimately led to the housing meltdown, pressured lenders into changing lending standards. Forget this 5-year track record of working in the same place, putting 20% down, having a good credit score. Oh, no. We need to diversify home ownership. And so banks were pressured, carrot and stick, into lowering lending standards. And I place that blame at people like Barack Obama. Why? When he was a private lawyer, he worked for a civil rights law firm and was part of a bunch of lawyers all over the country filing lawsuits against people like Citigroup, claiming that they were not granting mortgages because of racism. And in Obama's case, he and a class action lawsuit ultimately got a settlement. 186 of the plaintiffs received mortgages. A few years later, only 19 of them was able to maintain them. And one of the plaintiffs said, there ought to be a law to prevent banks from giving loans to people who can't pay them back. I'm not making this up. One of his own plaintiffs who lost a house said, there should have been a law to stop me from getting a house I couldn't afford. These are the kinds of people in charge right now. Have they said a word about the family? Have they said a word about crappy schools? 13 public high schools, Baltimore. Not to pick on Baltimore, the rest of the cities aren't doing much better. 13 public high schools where 0% of the kids can do math at grade level, and 6 more where only 1% can, and we're not having a discussion about that? And the number one donor to the Democratic Party is the teachers' unions, and they are adamantly opposed to vouchers K-12, while public school teachers living in the inner city who have school-age kids don't put their own kids in public schools, and you're not insulted, and you still pull that lever for the Democratic Party? But I'm the bad guy. Maxine Waters speaks for black people. Maxine Waters says that the police feel it's their job to keep black people down. 81% of blacks want the police to maintain their same level of manpower or have it increased. She speaks for black people? Black and brown people want vouchers, headline after headline. USA Today, voters strongly support school choice. Educators should listen. This is a think tank in Michigan. Democrat minority voters overwhelmingly favor school choice. New study shows African-American families overwhelmingly want a choice in school. Maxine Waters is opposed to school choice, but she speaks for black people. And Larry Elder, he's a sellout and an Uncle Tom and just catering to the white man, whatever the hell that means. She's making things worse in terms of police-civilian relations by causing the police to pull back, crime going up. She's opposed school choice. Now, Pete and Seth Talbot, the father-son owners of Relief Factor, are on a mission. They're going to double their number of customers in 2021. Here's how they're going to do it. The 3-week quick start is still discounted to $19.95. That's less than a dollar a day to see if we can get you out of pain. Back, shoulder, neck, hip, foot, knee pain, whether from exercise or just getting up and dealing with life every single day. $19.95, less than a dollar a day to see if we can get you out of pain. After that, well, that's less than the cost of a cup of coffee a day to stay out of pain. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com, 800-500-8384, 800-500-8384.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Man. Joe Manchin, Senator Joe, did a tele-town hall yesterday about West Virginians and why they vote Republicans. Listen to this, cut 18.
People asked me one time, they said, what happened to West Virginia? How come West Virginia's changed from a Democrat state to Republican state? How did that happen in the quickest amount of time that we've ever seen? I said, I can tell you how West Virginia feels. We feel like the returning Vietnam veteran. We've done every dirty job you've asked us to do. We never questioned. We did it and performed well. And now all of a sudden, we're not good enough. We're not clean enough. We're not green enough. We're not smart enough. You want to know why they quit voting for Democrats? That's the reason.
That's exactly. The entire country knows that a handful of elite Democrats think they're morons.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The Derek Chauvin trial was for many, many people fraught with rage and sadness and resentment, frustration, apprehension. What's going to happen as the verdict is reached? And yesterday, I think everybody was sort of stunned. I was watching the pundits react with amazement that the jury returned a verdict so quickly. And of course, all the analysts, all the
Hey, Brother Larry, man, good evening. How you doing? Check it out. Here's a question, okay? And hopefully we can get an answer once and for all and how we can get the results we want as Americans, true patriot conservative Americans, okay? How in the hell are we going to educate the young black millennials to tell them who the racist party is? Because that's just not getting across. So that's what we got to do. Is let them know exactly what party is the racist party. The young black millennials have to understand that. Because otherwise, right now the Democrat is pinning all the blame that the America did not do. It's the Democrats that's the racist.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. A lot of you want to weigh in. I'll take some calls at the top of the hour. So Jeremy, Wayne, Carl, Cheryl, Scott, please don't leave town. I was asked, have you ever reached out to any of these so-called black leaders and tried to convince them of the error of their ways? Please. We have invited Maxine Waters on the program over 50 times. I stopped a long time ago. Jesse Jackson, around the same number. I stopped a long time ago. Louis Farrakhan, around the same number. Stopped a long time ago. Sharpton, same thing. And I told you one of the so-called black leaders did come on my program. His name is Kwesi Mfume. He was in the president of the NAACP, longtime member of the U.S. House of Representatives from the Baltimore area. Now he's back in Congress in the Baltimore area. But at the time, he was the president of the NAACP, and I said, Mr. Mfume, as between the presence of white racism or the absence of black fathers, which poses the bigger threat to the black community? And to his credit, without missing a beat, the man said, as you heard me say many times before, he said, the absence of black fathers. But I did write a letter to Maxine Waters, And we posted it up on LarryElder.com. It's called Larry Elder's 2001 Letter to Representative Maxine Waters. She never responded. It's a long letter, too. Dear Congressman Waters, I wrote, I write this letter directly to you. No one else received copies. Your power in America, especially in the black community, is substantial. I honestly and sincerely urge you to rethink your positions on several issues. I have so far kept this letter private. I hope that after you read this letter, you will agree to have a one-on-one sit-down private conversation with me about the future and direction of black America. And I told her she was wrong on gun control, and I outlined why she was wrong on gun control. I told her she was wrong on race-based preferences, also known as affirmative action, and I explained why she was wrong on that. I told her she was wrong on the welfare state. I told her she was wrong the way that we're going about the war on drugs. I told her she's wrong about the amount of racism there is in America. And I wrote at the very end, in America, we see two black Americas. The majority black world reflects increased prosperity, growing home ownership, and steady asset accumulation. The other, the so-called black underclass, remains disturbing. Quite simply, we see too many people having children outside of wedlock. It stands far and away as America's number one problem. I await your response. Never heard back. You can read it.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
That confirms what we all sort of suspect. America's not in a good place right now. We're just not. I mean, here's a headline you won't see anywhere. Chauvin found guilty. The system worked. No. The progressives don't like that. AOC doesn't approve of that. AOC doesn't approve of that at all. In fact, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez seems very disappointed that Derek Chauvin got the maximum amount of guilt that he could have possibly received at yesterday's trial.
This verdict is not justice. Frankly, I don't even think we call it full accountability because there are multiple officers that were there. It wasn't just Derek Chauvin. And I also don't want this moment to be framed as this system working, because it's not working. And that's what creates a lot of complexity in this moment.
That's a lot of complexity in that, young lady. A lot of complexity in this moment. Justice was not served. In fact, there wasn't even any accountability. And if that wasn't a goofy enough take for you, how about Nancy Pelosi? Nancy Pelosi actually looked up into the heavens and thanked George Floyd for dying.
Thank you, George Floyd.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
You know, you hear a lot of people talk about end of days and whether we are preparing for the raptures. They can be easily forgiven because of all that is happening in our life. This country alone, don't look to the world, but to this country alone, we are watching the American heritage turned upside down. We're watching illegal immigrants given money by a government that denies it to those who are hardworking Americans with families to support. We are looking at a president who wouldn't answer a question, as I said, about packing the Supreme Court. But today, he's creating a commission and doing everything in his power to move toward another four justices that will dilute the court. It's just one thing after another. And one rational thing that he's done, which is to announce he's bringing home our troops from Afghanistan, that is what President Trump wanted to do years ago and was stymied at every turn by the military-industrial complex.
Yeah, we're not going to mention the neocons and Lindsey Graham because that would be inappropriate. Yeah. Have you been in touch at all? And you don't have to say if you, but I'm wondering if you've been in touch with the president at all.
I've seen him a number of times here. I guess most recently a week or so ago. And he, by the way, sounds great. He is sounds rested and he's obviously taking on issues every day.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Joe Manchin, Senator Joe, did a tele-town hall yesterday about West Virginians and why they vote Republicans. Listen to this, Cut 18.
People asked me one time, they said, what happened to West Virginia? How come West Virginia's changed from a Democrat state to a Republican state? How did that happen in the quickest amount of time that we've ever seen? I said, I can tell you how West Virginia feels. We feel like the returning Vietnam veteran. We've done every dirty job you've asked us to do. We never questioned. We did it and performed well. And now all of a sudden, we're not good enough, we're not clean enough, we're not green enough, we're not smart enough. You want to know why they quit voting for Democrats? That's the reason.
That's exactly. The entire country knows that a handful of elite Democrats think they're morons.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on The Mike Gallagher Show.
Derek Chauvin trial was for many, many people fraught with rage and sadness and resentment, frustration, apprehension. What's going to happen as the verdict is reached? And yesterday, I think everybody was sort of stunned. I was watching the pundits react with amazement that the jury returned a verdict so quickly. And of course, all the analysts, all the smart kids on TV said, that's not good for Derek Chauvin. And as it turned out, it was not good for Derek Chauvin. Guilty, guilty, guilty. And it sort of feels like America collectively let out a sigh of relief. Heard that metaphor a lot too. You heard that description. And we all know why people were relieved. First of all, millions of Americans legitimately believe that justice was served. But the other reason for the sigh of relief is a little more insidious, a little more nefarious, darker, a little scary. And that is the fact that Americans instinctively knew that if the verdict turned out any other way except guilty, 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 multiple cities would burn.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
I say this, I am looking at it very seriously, beyond seriously. From a legal standpoint, I don't want to really talk about it yet.
Beyond seriously. I'm looking at it beyond seriously.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. We've been talking about the verdict in the Derek Chauvin case, the rush to judgment, in the case of the Columbus police officer who shot and killed a black teenager, LeBron James, before he knew the facts, tweeted, "You're next," meaning the officer would likely be convicted of murder, as was Derek Chauvin. Turns out the officer in Columbus was a hero. LeBron James since deleted it, or somebody deleted it, but he didn't apologize. All of that and more, 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. Also, this is Can You Beat Kirk? Phone a Bro Friday. The categories for Can You Beat Kirk, which we'll be doing in the next hour, the final hour of the show, are This Week in the News, Sports, Aviation, the Bible, and Pop Music of the 2000s. So if you think you're strong in This Week in the News, Sports, Aviation, the Bible, and Pop Music of the 2000s, stick around for the third hour. More on this in due course. We'll also, of course, be playing Phone a Bro in the final hour. The irresponsible Maxine Waters might very well have made a statement that will cause the trial of Derek Chauvin to be determined a mistrial. And we may have to do the whole thing over again. Here is what Maxine Waters said.
Reform. And so, yes, I would like to see the bill in Congress pass on police reform, but I know that the right wing, the racists, are opposed to it. And I don't know what's going to happen to it, but I know this, we've got to stay in the street.
She also said this.
What should protesters do?
Well, we got to stay on the street, and we've got to get more active. We've got to get more confrontational. We've got to make sure that they know that we mean business.
Now, Alan Dershowitz, who, as you know, is a liberal, he voted twice for Obama. A man who also said, by the way, had he known about the photograph that Obama took, a smiling Senator Obama took with Louis Farrakhan, arguably the nation's most notorious anti-Semite, a photograph that did not see the light of day until after Obama was safely out of office. Alan Dershowitz has publicly said, had he known about the photograph, he never would have voted for Obama, let alone twice. And Alan Dershowitz said this about what Maxine Waters just said.
Well, first of all, the judge should have granted the motion for a mistrial based on the efforts of Congresswoman Waters to influence the jury. Her message was clearly intended to get to the jury. If you acquit or if you find a charge less than murder, we will burn down your buildings. We will burn down your businesses. We will attack you. We will do what happened to the witness, blood on their door. This was an attempt to intimidate the jury. It's borrowed precisely from the Ku Klux Klan of the 1930s and 1920s, when the Klan would march outside of courthouses and threaten all kinds of reprisals if the jury ever dared convict a white person or acquit a black person. And so efforts to intimidate a jury should result in a mistrial, but the judge, of course, wouldn't grant a mistrial because then he'd be responsible for the riots that would ensue, even though it was Waters who was responsible. And so now, if there is a conviction, and I think there will be a conviction, at least on the manslaughter charge, the issue will go to the Court of Appeals. And will the Court of Appeals have the courage to reverse this conviction on the ground? Now, there are many grounds of appeal, but on the ground that the jury was subjected to intimidation tactics, not only by Waters, but by others as well, who threatened violence in the event of an acquittal or a lesser charge than murder.
I wrote a piece called Derek Chauvin, the Great White Defendant. We have it up on LarryElder.com. And I talk about the fantastic novel written by Tom Wolfe called Bonfire of the Vanities. In it, he talks about the search on the part of the media, on the part of the prosecution, for what he called the Great White Defendant. A white person, male, conservative ideally wealthy, who's done something wrong. In the case of the book, The Bonfire Vanities, the white person was a suspect in a murder case. Hit a black kid in a black area of New York and just hit and ran. And it was a juicy case because the media was able to drive story after story after story. Tom Wolfe said that white people are used to being beaten up on. Many feel guilty, even feel vindicated when something like this happens. And so it's a win-win-win for everybody, including an ambitious DA who was in the book. And you notice We have a series of great white defendants in America. We had Don Sterling a few years ago. There was the Duke lacrosse team. There's Derek Chauvin. As if the number one thing going on in America is a bunch of wealthy white people committing crimes. As if that's what we ought to be concerned about. I told you about the polls that show urban parents want K through 12. They recognize that the school down the road only has 3% of kids that can do math at grade level, Larry Eldridge's former high school. What responsible parent puts their kid in the school where only 1% can do math at grade level, which is the case with a half a dozen public high schools in Baltimore, 13 where 0% can do math at grade level? What responsible parent does that? Which party says to this responsible parent, hey, the money should follow the child rather than the other way around. If you can get your kid out of that school into a better school, we're all for you. Here's how we're going to do it. But let's talk about Derek Chauvin. Let's talk about Duke lacrosse. Let's talk about Donald Sterling. It's manipulation. I've told you about Eric Holder, Obama's AG. When he was AG, he gives a speech. This is during the time when Donald Sterling was in the news, and ultimately, as you know, his team was taken away by the NBA because of racist comments he made that were recorded by his mistress in his own home, whatever. So Eric Holder gives a speech around the same time. And Eric Holder says, and I'm paraphrasing, you know, when something like what happened with Donald Sterling happens, this blatant racist stuff, we got that. We don't worry about blatant racism in America. Now, isn't that a concession? But I'll continue. He says, no, what we worry about is pernicious racism. And he gave three examples, each of which, as I've told you before, were bogus. Example number one, the push for voter ID. Well, blacks support voter ID almost to the same degree as whites do. What else you got? Well, he talked about the fact that a black criminal defendant who commits a crime, same crime committed by a white criminal defendant, gets a longer sentence. That's true. What he didn't tell you is that the U.S. Sentencing Commission says the reason for this is because the average black criminal has a longer conviction record than the average white criminal, and that record is taken into consideration when it comes to sentencing. You also, by the way, find that black judges sentence the same way as white judges do. Don't give me that. What else you got? And the third thing he said was that black boys are kicked out of school, K through 12, more so, and suspended and expelled more so than our white kids at that same school. And to that end, Jesse Jackson filed a lawsuit against the all-white Decatur, Alabama school system who had kicked out a bunch of black kids, making that very same allegation. And the school board pointed out that no matter the composition of the school board, the race of the teacher, the race of the principal, black boys are still kicked out disproportionately compared to other races in that given student body. Maybe, just maybe, it's because of behavior, and the district court judge threw out the lawsuit. So these are the so-called leaders telling you this is what the problems are? Meanwhile, Eric Holder is a partner at a law firm in Washington, D.C. called Steptoe & Johnson, making a minimum of $4 million. Obama moves into a compound in Martha's Vineyard worth $12 million, talking about how much racism there is in America's DNA. It's a joke! Meanwhile, the schools still suffer. Kids are still dropping out. I watched on a plane a movie called Charm City Kings about this motorcycle inner city urban culture in Baltimore. No dads, nobody going to school, nobody doing homework. It's based on a true story, and it's got a heroic ending. But I'm looking at this culture, looking at all these people in Baltimore, driving bikes up and down, all about macho, all about who can outdo this, outdo that, and then the drugs. Is that the route? To the middle class, selling drugs, rapping, playing basketball? Or is it doing homework every single night and building and building and building your future? And Jesse Jackson, Maxine Waters, Eric Holder, Barack Obama, you ain't helping. I'm Larry Elder.
Trending now on America First with Sebastian Burka.
I say this, I am looking at it very seriously, beyond seriously. From a legal standpoint, I don't want to really talk about it yet.
Beyond seriously. I'm looking at it beyond seriously. That was the 45th President of the United States. being asked about will he run for the White House again for 2024. Put the mics on, gentlemen, and get the headphones on. I'm going to survey the massive team here. It's going to take at least 3 hours to get all the answers in. This is America First on the Salem Radio Network. What does that mean to you?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Hey, where do you think we are in this country? Where do you think we are, and where do you think we may be going?
We are now with a president who refused to answer the questions straightforwardly as a candidate, who has now made it very clear he's going to make every effort with a high degree, a high probability of success, to pack the Supreme Court of the United States. This is something he avoided throughout the campaign. It was not his finest or most candid moment in his campaign, among, I would say, a number of such moments. So I think, you know, this is just the latest development in altering what is America, our government, and the relationship with the government. It's clear that there's an effort to change the relationship between the governed and the government, to make the government larger and more ubiquitous, if such a thing is imaginable. I think that, and partly the reason for that, if you will, suspended cognitive realization on the part of the American people, is because the national media, it's left-wing, but nonetheless, it is the national media, is not in any way bringing critical judgment or great energy to their responsibilities to be either a watchdog or to challenge power.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
Nancy Pelosi, I think, embodied this best. Do we have that clip of Nancy Pelosi? Yeah. So before I play that clip, Nancy Pelosi was talking about George Floyd. And I want you to think about this deeply. As she says this, she says, "Thank you, George Floyd, for dying." Only a religious person would be thanking somebody for dying if they believed that sacrifice was a martyr for a certain purpose. I kid you not, this is what Nancy Pelosi said. Play tape.
So again, thank you, George Floyd, for sacrificing your life for justice, for being there to call out to your mom. How heartbreaking was that? Call out for your mom. I can't breathe, but because of you, and because of thousands, millions of people around the world who came out for justice.
Hi, Larry. I was talking to a socialist that I know very well, and I told her about the state of New York giving out $15,600 as coronavirus relief per individual, and she was talking about, you know, taking a trip to New York State. And she said, well, can people from out of the state get it? And I said, that's pretty much one of the qualifications. And she said, what do you mean? And I said, well, to qualify, you can't be here with a green card, and you can't be a U.S. citizen, but other than that, they'll give it to anybody. And she didn't believe me. She checked it out, found out that is true. Have a great day, Larry.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. Please go to my website, LarryElder.com, if you support the new Georgia election law, if you don't believe that it is Jim Eagle, as Joe Biden said, if you think it's a lie that people standing in lines can't drink water, and it is a lie, if you think it's true that the voting really does extend to 7 p.m., not 5 p.m., as Joe Biden falsely said, then you might want to support the new Georgia election law. Go to my website, LarryElder.com. You'll see the banner that says Stand with Georgia at the very top. Next hour, we will be playing Phone a Bro and Can You Beat Kirk? I also want to read you a poem that a listener named Cheryl sent from Easley, South Carolina. She sent it shortly after my brother died, and I only now am aware of it. She resent it. She said, I wasn't sure you'd receive this. I kind of thought that if you had received it, you might have contacted me or said something on the air, so I thought I would send it again. Well, I did not see it. I'm so happy that you sent it again, and I will read it next hour, so please stick around for that. Thank you so much for that, Cheryl. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. While you were paying attention to the Derek Chauvin case, just a few headlines in my baby brown libertarian fingers. This is Fox News. Murders in Los Angeles up nearly 200%. Violent crime rising at rapid pace. I should point out that the mayor of L.A. has just diverted funds from the LAPD to youth programs. Another headline, New York Daily News. While mob beats customer inside Bronx McDonald's, steals her purse, and robs woman who tries to intervene. All I can tell you is that the crew of six men and women, based on the video I saw, appear to be black. Here's another one. New York Daily News. Brooklyn mom, 52, never saw killer ex-girlfriend who ran up from behind and shot her in the head at close range, cops, witnesses say. One more time. The New York Times helpfully told us that since the Derek Chauvin trial began, the police have killed more than three people a day. Before the Derek Chauvin trial began, the police killed more than three people a day. The year before the trial began, before anybody ever heard of Derek Chauvin or George Floyd, the police killed about three people a day. What the New York Times did not say is that since the Derek Chauvin trial began, over the 40 days, an average of 19 black homicide victims every day. Altogether, 760 blacks have been killed, mostly by other blacks, since the Derek Chauvin trial began, but the New York Times did not point that out. They just pointed out how many civilians police have killed over that period of time. Never mind, almost all have resisted with a weapon or with a knife, as was the case in connection with the shooting of the black teenager in Baltimore. The New York Times giving you the impression that the police are just a bunch of animals out there with firearms, out of control, making things worse. 888-971-SAGE is a number. Scott is in Las Vegas, Nevada. Scott, thank you very much for calling. I appreciate it.
Hey, Larry, how you doing?
I'm doing well, Scott.
Well, so I just wanted to call up here, more so because you kind of surprised me. I tend to not agree with you. I don't listen to you too much, but I just wanted to call up here and give you credit. Like what I heard you say about the trial, I really appreciated that because it feels like a lot of people on both sides have kind of made up their mind about the trial before they actually listen to all the evidence and listen to what the jury had to say. And I just respect you for saying, you know, you respect the decision of the jury. I also agree with what you said about Maxine Waters. And another thing I wanted to do was just to congratulate you on your film. I didn't think I'd be able to get through it, but I thought it was.
Come on, Scott. Am I that bad? You really thought it was going to be that bad?
it's more so because of the personalities you had, but you did a good job of balancing out like the real people, like the guy that you started the film with and ended it with, and right. The other girl that had kind of like her own farm in her yard.
Right.
I really appreciated those characters. So that's what kind of made the movie kind of pop for me. And I feel like it definitely should have got a lot more more praise, and it should have got a lot more attention by the media. But
I got shafted, Scott. I got shafted. Of the 15 films that were nominated by the Academy, Uncle Tom had a higher IMDb rating than any of them. It got shafted. I got no reviews from any of the major newspapers. I reached out to all of them, Scott. L.A. Times. It's my hometown newspaper. I'm born and raised here from the hood, Scott. I've had two best-selling books that made the L.A. Times bestseller list. They've never reviewed any of my books, didn't review my film. I'm born and raised here. I'm a success story from the hood, Scott. I got no love from my own hometown newspaper.
I know. Well, hopefully, you know, you guys can elect Caitlyn Jenner, and she'll be able to take care of that for you.
All right, Scott. Scott, thank you so much for calling. Have a good weekend, man.
You too. Thanks.
Appreciate it. No love over here. Let me tell you something to you liberals out there listening. I know you don't give a crap about me, and I don't expect you to. But I would think that you'd be worried about something. I've been bottle capped on Instagram. At 849, and then they took one away, now 848, about the same number for over a month. Same thing on my channel on YouTube. I was getting hundreds of followers today, a day, all of a sudden dead stop. Now, aren't you on the left worried about that? Now, people on the right are figuring out their own platforms. I'm not demanding or asking for any kind of government regulation. I think these are private platforms, and if they choose to shut Larry Elder down, they have a right to do that. But aren't you bothered by that on the left? Am I Al Sharpton? Am I Louis Farrakhan? But Larry Elder is being bottle capped on social media, on Twitter and on Instagram? That's okay with you? It's okay with you that Donald Trump's Twitter account has been permanently banned? That's all right with you? It's okay with you that Project Veritas's Twitter account also banned? That's okay with you? I would have thought people on the left, whether you're Jake Tapper, who's one of the more sensible guys on the left on CNN, I would have thought people like you would have said, whoa, whoa, whoa! You know, it's not that I like Donald Trump. It's not that I like people like Larry Elder. But for crying out loud, they can't even get their own ideas out without being slammed by social media. This is Orwellian. I would have thought people on the left would have had a problem. But I guess not. Honestly. Tweeting out something about how Project Veritas catches the CNN technical director saying, I'm really happy that we were slamming Joe Biden, Donald Trump, trying to buttress Joe Biden, showing him jogging so he can win. You tweet that and you're shut down? That's okay with you on the left?
Now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
And so if you're saying that he gave his life, we're glad that he did this. That's what Nancy Pelosi said. Thank you. She's thanking him. That's a completely different narrative than something happening to him. It's either he's a victim or he did this willingly. Now, you might just think I'm arguing semantics here, but words really matter when it comes to how we're portraying these events. And BLM Incorporated reacted as we might thought they, as we would have thought, they're not satisfied. Minnesota Attorney General Keith Ellison said this is not justice. Justice is not just one incident, but justice would be a transformational upheaval of the American system. You see, they call this just accountability. Their definition of justice is not the traditional Western or biblical view of justice, which is getting people what they deserve, giving them a process of the presumption of innocence. No, Keith Ellison's definition of justice is taking away property from people, taking away freedom from people, and redesigning society in his image. Cut 67.
That long, hard, painstaking work has culminated today. I would not call today's verdict justice, however, because justice implies true restoration. But it is accountability, which is the first step towards justice. And now the cause of justice is in your hands. And when I say your hands, I mean the hands of the people of the United States.
So they're intentionally redefining the word justice.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Why is Shakespeare hated? Did he have slaves? Right. That should do it on its own. Every nation had slavery. Are they all hated? Whites are hated for creating America and the West. That's why they want to bring down. They use white hatred as the cover for West hatred. Remember when President Trump gave this magnificent talk in Poland? Magnificent. On behalf of Western civilization. New York Times declared it a white supremacist talk. That's right. Makes perfect sense. They hate the West.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
I had called it murder from the first day I saw the tape, and so it took a long time to get there, but I can't say I'm surprised. I can't say anyone is surprised, and I know there's a lot of coverage about it, but more of relief for the family of George Floyd than anything else. Still, some politicians said remarkably dumb things, Nancy Pelosi taking the lead. Here's what she said, cut number 17.
Thank you, George Floyd, for sacrificing your life for justice, for being there to call out to your mom. How heartbreaking was that? Call out
all right,
to
that's
your mom.
George Floyd was murdered. George Floyd was murdered, and Nancy Pelosi attempting to turn a murder into a political statement is, to me, just nuts. He was murdered. He did not make it.
Hey, Larry, this is Joe from Buena Park. Larry, I'm afraid we're being controlled by the left through fear. I think many people know fear of violence, fear of cancel culture, fear of losing your job, fear of climate change, fear of the virus. This is the way they're going to control us. They've been controlling us, and this is their tactic. It's a fearful thing that they're doing to our nation.
Fear of racist Republicans. 888-971-SAGE. 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. Ask me anything with Senator Josh Hawley. I want to invite you to a special exclusive online event with Senator Josh Hawley on May 6th. Learn how to effectively address issues surrounding big tech, cancel culture, and the woke mob. Decades of unchecked data collection has given big tech more targeted control over American lives than any company or government in the world. Addressing that problem, Republican Senator Josh Hawley from Missouri has recently written a book called The Tyranny of Big Tech, where he argues that these megacorporations pose the gravest threat to American liberty in decades. What can we do about it? Senator Hawley is hosting an online event on May the 6th to discuss the issues surrounding big tech, and you're invited to ask him your personal question. It's an Ask Me Anything event. Take advantage of this exclusive time with a sitting U.S. Senator, and you'll get a copy of The Tyranny of Big Tech. Special offer only by invitation, so go to askahost.com for all the details and buy your tickets. That's askahost.com. Again, the third hour, next hour, we'll be playing Can You Beat Kirk and Phonebro. More on that in due course. This is the sign of the apocalypse. LeBron James puts out that irresponsible tweet about the officer who actually was a hero, who unfortunately had to shoot and kill a teenage knife-wielding black young lady who was, based on the video, on the verge of stabbing another black teenager and perhaps another. A neighbor there even said that had the police not acted as heroically as he did, the carnage could have been greater. But without waiting for any details, LeBron James sends out a tweet and says, "You're next," indicating that this cop is going to be the next one, like Derek Chauvin, to be found guilty of homicide. Took it down after he realized that maybe, just maybe, he should have gotten some more facts. Now, where does Larry get off saying sign of the apocalypse? O.J. Simpson. Let's remember, who butchered two human beings, including almost beheading his former wife with a knife. And he tweets out, quote, wait for the facts, hashtag LeBron James, O.J. Simpson. I kid you not. A guy who murdered two people with a knife is giving LeBron James advice on when to keep his powder dry when a teenager gets shot having wielded a knife. You cannot make this up. You cannot make up Mariah Carey tweeting after the Derek Chauvin conviction, quote, a small grain of hope for our future, says a woman with a net worth of $520 million. She wrote, a beginning, dot, 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 a small grain of hope for our future. Hallelujah. End of quote. Am I making this up? A small grain of hope for our future? America was on trial. I told you about the co-founder of Black Lives Matter, a self-described trained Marxist, who just purchased a $1.4 million home in Topanga Canyon, California, a black population of 0.4%. And I told you the story about Obama never having met Reverend Jeremiah Wright. It was from his first book. And he comes to see him, and Jeremiah Wright is talking out, trying to talk a single mom who works for him, who has a son who wants to move to the suburbs so he can join the marching band. And Reverend Jeremiah Wright is trying to talk him out of it because that boy won't know who he is if he moves to an all-white suburb. Guess where Reverend Jeremiah Wright's parishioners purchased a home for him to live in retirement? Area called Tinsley Park, outside Chicago. Black population, 1.92%. But apparently he's able to still remember who he is. You're being manipulated. You're being conned. Now, Pete and Seth Talbot, as I mentioned, are on a mission. They want to double the number of happy customers for Relief Factor. I suggest you order their three-week quick start, still discounted to only $19.95. If you have back pain, shoulder, neck, hip, foot, knee pain from exercise, or just everyday living, consider it. It's less than a dollar a day to see if we can get you out of pain. After that, well, less than the cost of a cup of coffee a day to stay out of pain. Over 70% of those who order the three-week quick start go on to order more. Give your body what it needs to heal itself. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com, or you can call 800-500-8384. That's 800-500-8384.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. President Biden has formally established a commission to consider adding seats to the Supreme Court. Justices Ruth Bader Ginsburg and Stephen Breyer, both appointed by a Democratic president, have opposed it, but the left is angry. They don't like the Supreme Court's rulings, so they want to change its composition. It's called court packing, from when, in 1937, Democratic President Franklin Roosevelt tried and failed to do it. President Biden must have forgotten he once called the idea of expanding the Supreme Court a terrible, terrible mistake and boneheaded. And make no mistake, it is a terrible idea. Any politically driven effort to change the court structure will only reinforce the perception that our judicial branch is guided by politics rather than by legal principle. Over time, a packed court would surely erode confidence in the rule of law, which is indispensable to governing a free people. I'm Carol Platt-Liebau.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu.
Trending now on America First with Sebastian Burka.
Well, I think most of the nation knows what Maxine Waters has done.
I mean, people are outraged, shocked, furious at how a sitting member of Congress can go to another state, a state she doesn't even live in, go past curfew, out into this dangerous area where Antifa, BLM, domestic terrorists have been rioting, causing violence, mayhem, attacking police officers, just like they have all year long. Maxine Waters goes there and tells them to stay in the streets, go past curfew. She's telling them to break the laws. And then she's telling them to get more confrontational. And then she's threatening a jury. And then hours later, the Minnesota National Guard gets shot at. They could have been murdered. All of this has been incited by Maxine Waters. And then I find out that Nancy Pelosi, the Speaker of the House, the woman that called all of us to Congress on January 11th to vote for impeachment. I voted against impeachment for President Trump. She wanted to impeach President Trump. She did impeach President Trump because all he said was to go march peacefully to the Capitol.
Yeah.
They're so outraged by this riot. But Nancy Pelosi, she rubber stamped Maxine Waters' words. Rubber stamped them.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
Wasn't just Derek Chauvin. And I also don't want this moment to be framed as this system working.
Hi, Larry. My name's Jerry. I'm a half black guy, half white guy from North Idaho. And I love your show. I love what you say. And I love what you stand for, man. Pull your boots up. Do your work yourself. I got you, man. Love you. Thanks.
888-971-SAGE. 888-971-7243. Larry Elder here. We are ReliefFactor.com studio, and next hour we will be playing Can You Be Kirk? The topics this week are This Week in the News, Sports, Aviation, the Bible, Pop Music of the 2000s, which will be an audio clue. So if you think you're sharp in This Week in the News, Sports, Aviation, the Bible, Pop Music of the 2000s, you might want to consider attempting to win a lot like me. Next hour, the number is 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. And then later on, that same hour, we will be playing Phone to Bro. More on that in due course. So you might want to get in line. And again, the winner will get a copy of A Lot Like Me, the book about my relationship with my father. And I do not give participation trophies. So if you lose, you lose. Sorry. 888-971-SAGE. I mentioned to you the co-founder of Black Lives Matter, Patrice Cullors, who purchased a $1.4 million home in Topanga Canyon, right outside Malibu here in California. According to the Epoch Times, Facebook and Instagram are censoring users from sharing a New York Post report about these homes purchased by her. Facebook users noticed on Thursday that they could not share the link to post article on Cullors' multi-million dollar property directly on their timeline or through their Messenger app. When a user attempts to share the link, they're blocked from doing so, and the following message is displayed. Your post could not be shared because this link goes against our community standards. If you think this doesn't go against our community standards, let us know. End of quote. Again, I would think even people on the left would be disturbed by this, because you're going to be next. Oh, you think you're safe? Obama is being attacked by some Hispanic activist in Waukegan, Illinois. There is a public school called Thomas Jefferson, and they want to rename it because, after all, he is an oppressor, their word, not mine. And local Hispanic activists said, Why should we put Obama's name on the school? We're just trading one oppressor for another because Obama is accused of being deporter in chief because of all the illegal aliens he deported, most of whom had been convicted of serious offenses or were new to the country. But he had been referred to as an oppressor. Meaning, if you're not down with doubling the minimum wage, you're not down with reparations, you're not down with D.C. and Puerto Rico statehood, you're not down with debt forgiveness, free college tuition, you're not down with expanding the Supreme Court, you're not down with getting rid of the filibuster, you're going to get canceled too. Just as Obama is being canceled or attempted to be canceled by these activists in Waukegan, Illinois. Breonna Taylor's mom is calling Black Lives Matter a fraud. Not Larry Elder, Breonna Taylor. You know, the woman who was killed in her home in Louisville, Kentucky by those U.S. Marshals. She's calling them a fraud. Michael Brown Sr. says out of the $90 million estimated to be raised by Black Lives Matter last year, he's gotten a whopping $500. But sharing a story about the $1.4 million home purchased by the co-founder, the self-described trained Marxist, is restricted on Facebook and on Instagram. And people on the left aren't saying anything. You guys don't care about this? This doesn't scare you? I know you hate Donald Trump's guts, but the idea that a former president of the United States, no matter how much you dislike him, can't communicate with his supporters via social media? Are you kidding me? That's okay with you? Because he's the purveyor of the big lie? If it's a big lie, then why are you worried about it? The way to combat a big lie with truth. And didn't give a damn about the big lie that Hillary pushed for 4 years. Every single moment of the day, she accused Donald Trump of being illegitimate. Used the S word many, many times. Stolen, stolen, stolen. Jay Johnson, Obama's Homeland Security, says, no evidence whatsoever that whatever the Russians attempted to do changed the outcome of the election. Yet 78% of Democrats, according to Gallup, not according to Elder or Fox News, 78% of Democrats believe that the Russians changed the outcome of the election. Never mind what Jay Johnson said under oath. Does anybody accuse Hillary of pushing the big lie of John Lewis, who referred to President Trump as illegitimate and racist, of course, wouldn't go to his inaugural address, wouldn't go to any of his State of the Union speeches because he called him illegitimate. 4 years. Nobody accused those guys of pushing the big lie. This is the double standard we're subjected to, and it's vulgar. And I would think even you on the left would recognize how vulgar this is. I know you hate Donald Trump, but Hillary was saying the same thing with less reason. You got Alan Dershowitz, you've got Jonathan Turley, these left-wing lawyers, law professors, both of them saying, well, the Pennsylvania case is a strong one. And they predicted the Supreme Court would take it up and that Donald Trump would win it. They were wrong. But these aren't whack jobs. These aren't white nationalists. You've got the Chief Justice of the Wisconsin Supreme Court filing a dissent, 4-3. She said, we should have heard the case on the merits. There are enough shenanigans here to undermine confidence in the integrity of our elections. You didn't get that in the 2016 election. So with less grounds, Hillary for 4 years has accused Donald Trump of having stolen the election, being illegitimate, and nobody but nobody accuses her of purveying the big lie. But Donald Trump is shut down of his Twitter account. How come Hillary still has a Twitter account? She's been pushing the election has been stolen for 4 years. No evidence. They didn't shut her butt down. But Donald Trump is incredibly unfair. And I would thank you on the left, Jake Tapper. You used to be pretty sensible. Where are you? I'm trying to think of some others who are sensible. Hard to find them. Where's the ACLU? Well, Larry, it's not public. Of course it's not public. But malls all of a sudden became public institutions. I would think that you would at least have an opinion about this. Awfully quiet. You're next. If Obama gets canceled, what do you think about you? Now, the doctors who design Relief Factor believe our bodies are designed to heal. That's right, designed to heal. And the docs who formulated Relief Factor selected the four best ingredients, each of which are 100% drug-free, to deal with pain from a different metabolic pathway. If you have back pain, shoulder, neck, hip, foot, knee pain from exercise, or just getting older, consider ordering the 3-week quick start. Only $19 a day, that's less than a dollar a day to see if it can get you out of pain. After that, well, less than the cost of a cup of coffee a day to stay out of pain. Over 70% of those who order it go on to order more. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com, 800-500-8384, 800-500-8384.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The Derek Chauvin trial was for many, many people fraught with rage and sadness and resentment, frustration, apprehension. What's going to happen as the verdict is reached? And yesterday, I think everybody was sort of stunned. I was watching the pundits react with amazement that the jury returned a verdict so quickly. And of course, all the analysts, all the smart kids on TV said, that's not good for Derek Chauvin. And as it turned out, it was not good for Derek Chauvin. Guilty, guilty, guilty. And it sort of feels like America collectively let out a sigh of relief.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
And so if you're saying that he gave his life, we're glad that he did this. That's what Nancy Pelosi said. Thank you. She's thanking him. That's a completely different narrative than something happening to him. It's either he's a victim or he did this willingly. Now, you might just think I'm arguing semantics here, but words really matter when it comes to how we're portraying these events. And BLM Incorporated reacted as we might thought they, as we would have thought, they're not satisfied. Minnesota Attorney General Keith Ellison said, this is not justice. Justice is not just
Larry, Rich in Scottsdale, love your show, love what you do. Hey, buddy, this whole voter ID thing, they're just going to keep saying it and saying it and saying it until a lot of people believe it. Keep repeating a lie. You need a voter ID. You need an ID to get a glass of liquor, a drink at liquor store, a bottle. You need ID to get on a plane. Is Delta racist because they require IDs? You need an ID to pick up tickets to go to a baseball game. I guess baseball stadiums are racist. You need an ID to get a hotel room. You need an ID to rent a car. Well, your driver's license, too. It's the dumbest thing. They're just going to keep pounding away. The media is such a SOB, lying bunch of...
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. About the Georgia election law, the lieutenant governor of North Carolina, a man named Mark Robinson, I met some time ago, had a few things to say, including resenting being used as a pawn because he's black. All of that and more, 888-971-SAG. Also, a gentleman named Marcellus Wiley, who follows the great Odersky on Twitter, had a few things to say about LeBron James and his tweet before he knew the facts regarding the teenager who was shot and killed by a police officer in Columbus. All of that, and then we're going to be playing Can You Beat Kirk and Phonebro in the third hour, 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. Ray is in Livermore, California. Ray, you're on the Larry Elder Show. Thank you so much for calling.
Hey, Larry, thanks for your great show. Love what you do. I got Uncle Tom, great movie. I purchased the CD, sharing it with friends. Everybody digs it.
Thank you.
So, good job. I want to speak about the trained Marxist, and if time allows, I have a tip for Phonebro callers.
Okay.
So, there was a term back in, I think, in the 60s, where black families would move into all-white neighborhoods. It was called blockbusting, mm-hmm. I believe. Is mm-hmm. that correct?
That's correct.
Sound familiar?
Yep.
Maybe the trained Marxist is trying to blockbust in Topanga Canyon.
Maybe so.
Could it be, Larry?
That's it. She's a civil rights leader. Here I am. I took it the wrong way.
And she's paving the way. So
paving the way.
Just come on into Topanga Canyon now. It's all wide open.
As long as you got 1.4 as long as you got 1.4 million, come on in. Diversify Topanga
there
Canyon.
There you go. And then for the Phonebro callers.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a two-time Phonebro champion. Thank you very much, and thank you for the books and the pillows.
You got it.
Here's how you win Phonebro. You listen to the show. It's on from 3 to 6 Western time, 5 days a week. Listen to the show. It's in the bag. You just got to listen.
Ray, thank you so much for the call. I appreciate it. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. Phonebro, can you beat Kirk up next? 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. I received a delightful poem about my late brother from a listener named Cheryl. She sent it shortly after he died, and I never saw it. She resent it because she thought that I would have been moved by it, so to the point where I at least would have said something to her, and she's right. Thank you so much for sending it back. We're going to read it later on. Now, I mentioned that LeBron James tweeted before he had any idea what the facts were about the shooting of a black teenager who had a knife. Based on the video, appeared to be about ready to plunge it into another black teenager, if not another one. A neighbor said that but for the heroic quick action of the police, this neighbor feels that the carnage could have been greater. LeBron James tweeted, "You're next," meaning the officer is going to be the next one to be convicted, as was Derek Chauvin. And he then took the tweet down when he found out more facts. Now, there is a sportscaster, former athlete, named Marcellus Wiley, who follows me on Twitter. And he had a few things to say about Mr. James's hasty tweet. And I am confident that maybe, just maybe, some of the things I've said on my program, some of the things I've tweeted, might have influenced Mr. Wiley to some degree. Anyway, here is what Mr. Wiley said about Mr. James.
Let's start here. I want to actually pray that his profoundness matches the power of his platform. I say it again. His profoundness will one day match the power of his platform. You basically said that, like, dog, you can't do this. You can't be that irresponsible if you're LeBron James because you have that much power. And we all know when you get that type of power, the responsibility comes with it. The accountability that was deleted in that tweet is ironic. Like, to put up hashtag accountability, which is something that we all need right now in this moment. Accountability on all sides with all people. Whether you're talking about the police officers, whether you're talking about the individuals in this situation, or even the victim in this situation. Every situation with accountability, not just rooting interests. And that's what's interesting about this. LeBron James, in terms of what he does for his day job, being a basketball player, second best at worst ever, maybe the GOAT. It's amazing. There's one glaring critique on his resume that he defers in critical times. Damn, I wish that was true in this moment. When it's a real issue, not just basketball wins and losses and points scored. When it's real life issues, where's the deferring? In that moment, LeBron, until all the facts come out, till you watch the video, till you come out and see what's right from wrong in this situation, he should have passed in this moment. Mm-hmm. You know, people always say, and I'm not agreeing with that, shut up and dribble. Nah, just shh and pass. Wait for it to come, and then you'll be able to see things clearer. But this is what happens when you want to be first, not right. And he has that platform. He has that power. He has those followers. And he knows that those people are listening for every single word that he's going to profess. So it's crazy. You said check your emotions if you're not emotional. I'm going to check them. Because emotions can't trump logic. And that's what's happening. Your agenda can't go before your acumen. You can't pander before your principles. And right now, even if you get all the likes and all the retweets, you know what I say about social media. Man, I am tired of people always going out there for likes and followers. Where's the love in the leaders? And LeBron James, in so many respects, God, you're well-intended. In so many respects, God, you do the greatest in what you touch and in endeavors, opening the schools, etc. We know his charitable contributions, how big his heart is. But you can't forget up here. Because the statement goes like this. I don't care how smart you are if you don't stop and think. LeBron James, he failed in that moment. Don't give a damn how smart you are if you don't stop and think. This is a moment that he regrets, and I think that his ego, I think that LeBron James was selfless enough to say, oh, this is hurting more than it's helping. Remember, there are three sides to every story. Your side, their side, and the truth that meets somewhere in the middle. And I get the pull. I get why LeBron James wants to be first. And right, of course, but first. But in this moment, come on. Who in the hell is looking at this situation any different? The cop has an impossible choice, which is to save a life, I'm going to have to take a life. And it's just that simple. Like, I get what we want to say, but this happened over here, but that ain't this. Yep. I'm talking about right here. And when you're that powerful, LeBron, you have that platform, you have to stay in that play, to use basketball terms. You have to stay in that vacuum. It's just interesting when that happens. But LeBron James, man, it's been a lot of missteps, man. And I'm not going to balance it out because I think the good outweighs the bad, certainly. But LeBron James has to understand, man. He goes out there and says, well, you know, we live in two different Americas. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that America's divided. I just think we're different. And right now it's getting highlighted more so than ever. So it's getting exaggerated. LeBron says he's scared to leave his house. Why? What? I'm not scared to leave my house, and I'm not LeBron James. I'm not enamored like LeBron James. He's scared to leave his house. We could have that conversation another day. LeBron James in this tweet, what does he say? Oh, man, the system. The system, the same system that is so broken, it allowed you to become a billionaire and never get arrested in it. But the system is broken. Are you speaking for other people? We have enough people out here telling us what not to do, what goes wrong. How about somebody who has made it? Single parent. LeBron James, what, he went to 10 different homes, moving around Ohio his entire childhood? I would love to hear that story of how you became LeBron James against all odds, instead of always professing the odds are against all people. I love LeBron James. You know, I think he's the GOAT. So don't get me started on this, but you got to look before you leap. In anything in life, I don't give a damn if you're rich, poor, or ugly. You got to look before you leap. LeBron just leaped in this one because he knew his followers would catch him. And that's a problem. I give it to you like this. One, your skin is not your sin. So when people start saying, well, entertainment and athletics, yeah, and other lanes, we're over here now having our kids grow up in a world where they're going to know victims' names before they know professors' names and wise scholars like Thomas Sowell or something like that. But here's the sentence.
Did he just say Thomas Sowell? I think he just said Thomas Sowell. You don't think he's reading my stuff?
We're over here now having our kids grow up in a world where they're going to know victims' names before they know professors' names and wise scholars like Thomas Sowell or something like that. But here's the sentence. Tell me how you feel about this sentence. LeBron James says, I'm so damn tired of seeing black people killed by police. Mm-hmm. With that platform. How about this sentence? Instead of that, I'm so damn tired of seeing black people killed. A little different. You ain't speaking. How about this sentence? Even more idealistic. I'm so damn tired of just seeing people killed. In the misstep, I can't excuse that. In the misstep, like, we harp on a play in a football game, and we will spend a whole show on that. Yeah. But then on this, because we like LeBron, and he's wrapped in so much love because we not only respect his game, but his commitment to his family, to his community, blah, blah, blah. But the irresponsibility that shows in the micro makes me say, be responsible about the macro. Like, dog, 250 black people killed by police every year. That's 250 too many people. Mm-hmm. But in the macro sense, there's 7,500 homicides to black people every single year as well. I'm not saying, LeBron, you got to put the focus on that fully, but let's be responsible. We're going to just go in there and say, I want to save 250 people, which we all do. But there's 7,500 in totality that never gets the discussion because the people with the platform are not highlighting that. And that's, look, I grew up trying to navigate around that. Mm-hmm. I am not scared of the police, brother. I wasn't then. I'm not now.
Send your angry cards and letters to Marcellus Wiley, W-I-L-E. What have I been telling you? LeBron, you have a big megaphone. It is, as KRS-One said, a responsibility and a burden. Responsibility, know what you're talking about. Not make things worse. Blacks are afraid to leave their home because of white people? Why does this, quote, keep happening? It doesn't keep happening. You know you've gone too far when OJ checks you and tells you about when a knife is dangerous and not. Sign of the apocalypse. Okay, can you beat Kirk up next? I'm Larry Elder.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Hatred of the whites. Is it because of slavery? And my argument is that it is not. Why is Shakespeare hated? Did he have slaves? Right. That should do it on its own. Every nation had slavery. Are they all hated? Whites are hated for creating America and the West. That's why they want to bring down. They use white hatred as the cover for West hatred. Remember when President Trump gave this magnificent talk in Poland? Magnificent. On behalf of Western civilization. New York Times declared it a white supremacist talk. That's right. Makes perfect sense. They hate the West. The left hates the West. The left hates order. The left hates capitalism. I point out in my column that Hitler hated capitalism as well. Major work. I read the entire book, a new biography of Hitler, by a professor at Cambridge. So that's a good credential for those of you who want credentials. And it's a lot about his hatred of capitalism. Remember, Nazism stands for National Socialism.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
The call. The other thing I want to ask you about is Brent Griffiths in his Business Insider newsletter this morning. Finally came up with a number of aid for in the Biden stimulus package. The giveaway to New York City is $5.6 billion. How is that going to play in the Arizona, Georgia, New Hampshire Senate elections where Democrats are on their back foot?
It's not going to play well, especially when New York City is doing things like giving large amounts to people who are undocumented, illegal immigrants, and just using this aid money in ways that are not permitted by not done by the federal government.
You can't work for ICE or CPB anymore. There's a memo out. You cannot use the term illegal immigrant. Now, I've always preferred undocumented since it is more comprehensive as to what we're talking about, but they have outlawed the use of illegal alien. So you're kind of outlawed, well, Byron.
A congressional appearance by Alejandro Mayorkas, the head of Homeland Security. He was asked repeatedly, now is
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studios. Time to play Can You Beat Kirk? We have two candidates. Betsy from Floresville, Texas versus Mark from St. Louis, Missouri. I was just right outside St. Louis giving a speech at Principia College in Illinois. But Betsy called first. Betsy, you get to go first. Betsy, how are you? I'm doing great, Betsy.
Wonderful. I'm excited about playing.
All right. The categories this week, Betsy, are This Week in the News, Sports, Aviation, The Bible, and Pop Music of the 2000s, which will be an audio clue. Where would you like to start first?
The Bible.
The Bible. This ought to be a slam dunk for you.
What?
Betsy, how many apostles did Jesus have?
12.
I thought that would be a piece of cake for you, and it was. We have four categories left. Betsy is now taking the commanding lead, 1-0 over Mark. This week in the news, sports, aviation, and pop music of the 2000s left, which will be an audio clue. Where next, Betsy?
Oh, my gosh. I want to stay with the Bible. Okay, how about in the news?
Okay. We only have one question per category. It doesn't work that way.
Oh, dear.
In the news.
Oh, dear.
Ex-Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin was found guilty on 3 counts in the death of George Floyd. Who is Chauvin's defense attorney?
Oh, gosh. I have no idea.
No idea. All right. Okay. All right, Betsy, you got to hold on. Don't go anywhere. Mark is now joining the contest. Mark, the score is Love 1. The category is This Week in the News. The question is, ex-Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin was found guilty on 3 counts in the death of George Floyd. Who is Chauvin's defense attorney, Mark?
Sorry, Larry, I don't remember that name either.
Okay. Let's go back to Betsy, who gave the last correct answer. Betsy and Mark, the answer is Eric Nelson. He was the defense attorney.
Okay.
Yeah. Obviously, you didn't pay a whole lot of attention to the trial, and no reason to, because it wasn't that big of a deal as far as the country is concerned, as far as I'm concerned. I know people on the left thought it was a referendum on America, but it really wasn't. That's why a whole lot of people weren't paying attention to it, and you're probably one of them. No problem to me. Sports, aviation, pop music of the 2000s left. Betsy, where next?
Oh, my gosh. I don't know any of those.
You'll be surprised.
I think Mark's going to win. Okay. Aviation, I guess.
That's the spirit. I think Mark's going to win. You're ahead, young lady. It's 1-0. You're ahead. Okay, the question is, the category is aviation. Here's the question. This state is known as the birthplace of aviation. What state am I talking about, Betsy? 1-0, Betsy,
Ohio.
Over Mark. Ohio. You know what? It's interesting you should say that. You are right, because a lot of people, Betsy, say North Carolina, because that's where Kitty Hawk is, where they tested the plane. But it was developed, designed, and even test-flighted in Ohio. In Ohio, having lived in Ohio for 17 years, Betsy, I can tell you, Ohioans are very upset that North Carolina tried to take credit for it. But I'm digressing. 2-0 over Mark. The categories remaining are sports and pop music of the 2000s, which will be an audio clue. Where next, Betsy?
Good. I don't listen to pop music. Oh, I guess I'll go with, I know nothing about sports. Okay, I'll go with sports.
Okay.
I know nothing.
All right, we'll see. In terms of the biggest TV audience, Betsy, this is the most popular female sport in America. In terms of the largest TV audience, this is the most popular female sport in America. What sport am I talking about, Betsy? Score is 2-0.
Tennis.
Score is 2-0, Betsy over Mark. I'm sorry, did you say something?
Tennis.
Negative. All right. Don't go away, Betsy. We're back to Mark. Mark, it is Love 2. Let's pick it up, Mark. In terms of the largest TV audience, this is the most popular female sport in America. Your opponent said tennis. She was wrong. What do you say?
I say soccer.
You say soccer. And you are correct, sir. All right, Mark, you've now taken control of the board. You may be able to tie this puppy up. The final question is pop music of the 2000s. It's an audio clue. Are you ready, sir?
Yes.
All I need to know is the name of the artist. Here we go. Mark, I'm not feeling it.
No, I'm just going to just take a stab at it and say Cardi B.
Cardi B. That would be a Negatron. Let's go back to Betsy. Betsy?
I don't have Madonna. I have no idea.
You have no idea. You said Madonna. Well, that's okay. It's Lady Gaga. But you win this contest 2-1.
Somebody give me an amen.
Well done, Betsy.
I get the book about your dad.
Pardon me?
I get the book about your dad.
You sure do.
Oh, that is wonderful. That is fantastic. I was hoping I would win that book.
Well, you sure did. And let's put Mark back on. Betsy, don't go away. And Betsy, don't hang on. We need to get your information to get you the book. Mark, come on, Lady Gaga. What are we talking about here?
Yeah. I should have known that. But I got to tell you, Betsy sure is a good sport. She wanted me to win, huh?
Yeah, she thought you were going to win. But Betsy, Mark, very well played. And Betsy, good job. So stick on the line, and we'll make sure that that you get a copy of the book. It's called A Lot Like Me. Now, I mentioned that a young lady named Cheryl sent a poem after my brother died. The world around heaves a collective sigh. Another week at last says goodbye. Many have their thoughts on the weekend, but for me, there are still wedding cakes to tend. Fridays for me are usually an all-nighter, but I smile knowing the sage will make it lighter. I hope to hear a good story told when Kirk is on the air to play Phonebro. Oh yeah, the deep voice of the familiar song plays, and Larry introduces Kirk Randolph Elder today. The brotherly chatter and playful banter makes me smile and brings me laughter. I look forward to hear a shared childhood story or reminisces on days of glory. But as life has its seasons and waves leave the sea, another chance to hear the brothers is not to be. The Lord has called Kirk Elder home. I felt shock and sadness to the bone. I feel a tear run down my cheek. I wipe it as I begin to weep. I stop immediately and admonish myself, how silly to cry when I see the book on my shelf. For a man to whom I am not known, for a life no seeds I have sown. I listened to many calls over the airways of heartfelt sympathies and shared memories he gave. I realize I'm not so silly at all. There's a lot of love out there for a man we call. I feel lucky to have gotten a chance to play a round of Phonebro with Kirk Elder and say, can I have one of those famous hints, please, with the gentle grace and humor he gives me a tease. I know he is happy you continue to play. Can you beat Kirk and Phonebro each Friday before you sign off each week and go home? I know from heaven I hear I love you, bro. By Cheryl, B as in boy, from Easley, South Carolina. Cheryl, thank you so much. God bless.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Man. Joe Manchin, Senator Joe, did a tele-town hall yesterday about West Virginians and why they vote Republicans. Listen to this, Cut 18.
People asked me one time, they said, what happened to West Virginia? How come West Virginia's changed from a Democrat state to a Republican state? How did that happen in the quickest amount of time that we've ever seen? I said, I can tell you how West Virginia feels. We feel like the returning Vietnam veteran. We've done every dirty job you've asked us to do. We never questioned. We did it and performed well. And now all of a sudden, we're not good enough. We're not clean enough. We're not green enough. We're not smart enough. You want to know why they quit voting for Democrats? That's the reason.
That's exactly. The entire country knows that a handful of elite Democrats think they're morons.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The Derek Chauvin trial was for many, many people fraught with rage and sadness and resentment, frustration, apprehension. What's going to happen as the verdict is reached? And yesterday, I think everybody was sort of stunned. I was watching the pundits react with amazement that the jury returned a verdict so quickly. And of course, all the analysts, all the smart kids on TV said, that's not good for Derek Chauvin. And as it turned out, it was not good for Derek Chauvin. Guilty, guilty, guilty. And it sort of feels like America collectively let out a sigh of relief. Heard that metaphor a lot too. You heard that description. And we all know why people were relieved. First of all, millions of Americans legitimately believed that justice was served. But the other reason for the sigh of relief is a little more insidious, a little more nefarious, darker, a little scary. And that is the fact that Americans instinctively knew that if the verdict turned out any other way except guilty, 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 multiple cities would burn.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
I say this, I am looking at it very seriously, beyond seriously. From a legal standpoint, I don't want to really talk about it yet.
Beyond seriously. I'm looking at it beyond seriously. That was the 45th President of the United States being asked about will he run for the White House again for 2024. Put the mics on, gentlemen, and get the headphones on. I'm going to survey the massive team here. It's going to take at least 3 hours to get all the answers in. This is America First on the Salem Radio Network. What does that mean to you?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
So why the heck did I let somebody stick a needle in my arm twice and I still got to wear this stupid mask? I asked a guy in the parking lot at Walmart about that, and he says it's because it's only 90% effective. Well, Fauci said it was 97%. He also said at the beginning that you didn't have to wear a mask, and now you do. Why are we paying him $413,000 a year not to tell us the truth? Thanks, Larry. Bye now.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. Coming up, we're going to play Phone It Bro. It'll be Jane from Louisville, Kentucky, and Mike from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So, gentlemen, do not leave town. I want to invite you to attend a special and exclusive online event with a U.S. Senator on May the 6th. Learn how to effectively address issues surrounding big tech, cancel culture, and the woke mob. Decades of unchecked data collection has given big tech more targeted control over American lives than any company or government in the world. Addressing that problem, Republican Senator Josh Hawley from Missouri has written a book called The Tyranny of Big Tech, where he argues these mega corporations pose the gravest threat to American liberty in decades. What can we do about it? Senator Hawley is hosting an online event on May the 6th to discuss the issues surrounding big tech, and you're invited to attend and ask him your personal question. It's an Ask Me Anything event. Take advantage of this exclusive time with a sitting U.S. Senator, and you'll get a copy of his book, The Tyranny of Big Tech. The special offer is by invitation only, so go to askahost.com for all the details and to buy your tickets. That's askahost.com. The letter that I wrote back in 2001, that's 20 years ago, to Maxine Waters is posted up on LarryElder.com. For those of you who are calling and asking me, what did she say, what did she do? She never responded. Never heard back from her at all. I think she's too busy whipping out race cards. It's a very lengthy letter where I go over a bunch of issues where I think she's wrong, including gun control, including school choice, including affirmative action, including the amount of racism in America. I outline my position. I give cites and recitations. It's a pretty long letter. And I just assume that somebody from her staff would call back and tell me I'm full of it or something, but I didn't hear from anybody. Anyway, it's up on LarryElder.com. You can read it yourself. The New York Times, I mentioned earlier in the show, helpfully reminded us that since the beginning of the Derek Chauvin trial, quote, since the trial began on March 29, more than three people a day have died at the hands of law enforcement, the Times has found, end of quote. Well, according to the Washington Post, updated in July, updated April 17, 2001, excuse me. Quote, rate of shootings remain steady. Quote, despite the unpredictable events, writes the Washington Post, that led to fatal shootings, police nationwide have shot and killed almost the same number of people annually, nearly 1,000 since the Post began its project, end of quote. Back in the New York Times, since the trial began on March 29, more than three people a day have died at the hands of law enforcement. According to the Washington Post, that's pretty much what it's been for a long time. What the New York Times didn't say is that an average of 19 black homicide victims occur each day, which means over the course of the Derek Chauvin trial, 40 days, 760 black homicide victims. Did the New York Times add up that total? No, guess not. Multiple 911 calls to the foster home where Makia Bryant lived. Since November, seven calls to the home on Legion Lane in Columbus, Ohio. Not the first time the police were called. And even Don Lemon, who I watch on CNN, so you don't have to, got the Columbus shooting right.
I think it was like 7 seconds, 7 or 9 seconds that the officer had to react. It is tragic. It is terrible. But imagine if the woman in the pink was your loved one and the officer didn't do what he did.
Intelligent life, broken clock.
You could be mourning the death of that woman, that young lady in the pink. And again, I know that people say, well, he should have shot for the leg. And that's not, you had, what's the guy you have on with the glasses? I forget what you call him.
Anthony Barksdale.
Barks, you call him Barks. That's not the training for police officers.
Well, duh.
Officers are trained to neutralize the threat.
You do not pass leather, which is how they refer to, like, coming out of the holster.
Yeah.
If you are not planning to neutralize a threat,
right.
And you must use equal or greater force.
Yeah.
So they're not taking out that gun to do anything. But
well, at least they got that one right. By the way, the 12 apostles, Bartholomew, Andrew the Apostle, Matthew, Peter, James the Great, Thomas the Apostle, John, Philip the Apostle, Judas Iscariot, Simon the Zealot, Matthias, James, son of Alphaeus. Now, a gas station sells regular unleaded for $4, but the one next to it sells for $2. Which one are you going to buy? No brainer. So why are you still paying these high rates for wireless with Verizon, T-Mobile, or AT&T when you could get the exact same coverage as one of those big carriers, except it costs you half? The average family saves $800 a year. Get unlimited talk, text, and 6 gigs of data for just $30 a month. And if you go over data, they don't charge you for it. Switching is easy. You can keep your phone, keep your number, or choose from the latest iPhone and Androids. Make the smart choice like I did and switch to Pure Talk. Just dial #250 and say Larry Elder to save 50% off your first month. That's #250 and say Larry Elder, because Pure Talk is simply smarter wireless.
Now on America First with Sebastian Burka.
I was there front row in the ellipse listening to my old boss, President Trump, on January the 6th. Video cut to play cut.
I know that everyone here will soon be marching over to the Capitol building to peacefully and patriotically make your voices heard.
That's what he said, to peacefully and patriotically make your voices heard. This is what Maxine Waters, who has a track record of doing this, as Congresswoman Green just said, after curfew, not even in her another constituency of her state, in another state, said yesterday. Video cut one, play cut.
Oh, no, not manslaughter. No. This is guilty for murder. I don't know whether it's in the first degree, but as far as I'm concerned, it's first degree.
Congressman, what happens if we do not get what you just told? What should the people do? What should protesters on the street do?
I didn't hear you.
What happens?
What should protesters do?
Well, we got to stay on the street, and we've got to get more active. We've got to get more confrontational. We've got to make sure that they know that we need business.
This has got to be personal for you because you're being accused and for months of the worst things. They're throwing you off your committee assignments, trying to get you kicked out of Congress. When you hear women, Congress women, say more violence, more confrontational, what does it mean for your supporters and for patriots, Congresswoman?
Oh, this is personal for me on every level because the whole reason why I ran for Congress is for people over politicians. This government is out of control. And they think it's the other way around. These politicians here in the swamp, they think that all of this is here to serve them, and that's how they operate.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Hatred of the whites. Is it because of slavery? And my argument is that it is not. Why is Shakespeare hated? Did he have slaves? Right? That should do it on its own. Every nation had slavery. Are they all hated? Whites are hated for creating America and the West. That's why they want to bring down. They use white hatred as the cover for West hatred. Remember when President Trump gave this magnificent...
I'm too fast.
Champion from
the
crib.
I'm the king.
King of
the
town. Born a champ from the crib. Ah!
I'm feeling great. I'm ready to go to war right now. I'm handsome, I'm fast, I'm pretty, and can't possibly be beat.
I have tussled with a whale, I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail. Now you know I'm bad. Only last week I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean I make medicine sick.
That can only mean one thing. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. It is time for Phonebro. Kirk, what are the rules?
Okay, Larry is going to play 5 sound clips from this week's show. And all you have to do is guess who's speaking. And if you can't guess, then you can ask for a clue. Phonebro, and you'll get one of my world-renowned clues to help you get the answer.
We have 2 contestants. We have Jane from Louisville, Kentucky, Mike from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. James called first, and James is from the hometown of Muhammad Ali, whose sound bites we just now played. James, how are you?
He is the Louisville Lip, Mr. Cassius Clay.
Absolutely he is. Now, James, are you born in Louisville?
Absolutely. Born, bred, and always lived here, yes.
Okay, name the police officer who taught Muhammad Ali how to box.
Oh man.
He was a police officer. As you know the story, he had his bike stolen from him. So he goes to the police station, and he says, I want to beat up the guy who stole my bike. And the cop says, you know how to box? He says, no. There was a gym right below, and he was the first guy to teach him how to box. His name was Morton, Joe Morton. And later on, he was asked, did you think that this guy was going to be that good? He says, not really. He was tall. He was fast, but no taller, no bigger than some of the other guys. The thing is, when he got hit in the mouth, he came back the next day. Most kids that get hit in the mouth, they never show up again. Anyway, let's do this, James. The first one, you have to get on your own. By the way, are you going to go first, or you want your opponent to go first?
I'll go first, but let me say this. Muhammad Ali had some awful, awful big fists. I mean, he had an anvil for the frontage of the part where he hit with.
I'll take your word for that. I've never measured his fist. All right, James, let's do this. The first one, you got to get on your own. Who is this?
Well, we got to stay on the street, and we've got to get more active. We've got to get more confrontational. We've got to make sure that they know that we need business.
Who is that person?
That'd be my sister from a different mother, Maxine Crazy Ass Waters.
Soundbite number two, and you can use a phonobro for this one, if necessary.
What? What measure? What, I mean, are we just going to continue this forever? Or when do we get to the point? What measure? What standard? What objective outcome do we have to reach before Americans get their liberty and freedom back?
James, who is that gentleman? James, did you hear it?
Yes, I did, and I don't think I heard that one.
I'll play it again. Here we go.
What measure? What, I mean, are we just going to continue this forever? Or when do we get to the point? What measure? What standard? What objective outcome do we have to reach before Americans get their liberty and freedoms back?
And you can use a phone abroad if necessary.
I don't need. It's the senator from Midwest. Is that Josh Hawley?
No, it was not. You've now lost control of the board. It now goes to Mike. Mike is in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Mike, let me play it again for you.
What? What measure? What, I mean, are we just going to continue this forever? Or when do we get to the point? What measure? What standard? What objective outcome do we have to reach before Americans get their liberty and freedoms back?
Mike, if you need a phone abroad, you can get one.
I don't think I need one. I think that's Senator Kennedy from Louisiana.
Negative, gentlemen. You both got it incorrect. Back to James, who gave the last correct answer. That speaker was Jim Jordan from Ohio, the House member.
Oh.
All right, we're at soundbite. We're at soundbite number three. You're still in control of the board, James. Here we go.
You're asking for a number. If I have a number, it would have to be my best estimate. And that would be that the number of infections per day are well below 10,000 per day.
James, who is that gentleman?
Would that be that guy that doesn't know his a-hole from a...
Be careful.
...hologram Fauci?
It certainly would be. Soundbite number four, inching closer to the fifth and final clue. James is still in control of the board. Here we go.
And you know what the answer is? You really do. You don't like it. I don't like it. It scares me. Shootings? Gun laws? Access to weapons? Oh, yeah, I know when they'll change. Your kids start getting killed? White people's kids start getting killed?
Again, you can use a phone abroad if necessary. Who is that gentleman?
I think I want to let this one go for the last one.
I'm sorry. You mean you're going to say you don't know and you let your opponent answer?
That is would be correct. Yeah.
You don't want to try? You don't want to get a phone a bro? You want to let this one? All right.
You talked me into that last time, and I'm
okay. Not a problem. Not a problem. Okay, James, don't go away. Mike, you're on board. Mike, I'll play it again for you.
And you know what the answer is? You really do. You don't like it. I don't like it. It scares me. Shootings, gun laws, access to weapons. Oh, yeah, I know when they'll change. Your kids start getting killed. White people's kids start getting killed.
Now, Mike, your opponent thinks you don't know the answer to that. He strategically gave it to you in hopes you're going to stumble. He gets the fifth and final clue. So, Mike, you can use a phone, bro, if you need it. If you need a hint, I'll give you one.
Yes, I could use the phone, bro.
He is the host of a daily show, Monday through Friday show on CNN, who I watch and you don't have to.
I never watch CNN. No. I'll say Jake Tapper.
Jake Tapper. That's an interesting guess. No, the answer is Chris, don't call me Fredo Cuomo. So, James, you might very well have played this perfectly. Here is the fifth and final clue, and you can even use a phone bro if you need one. So you're in really good shape. Here we go.
So today Twitter suspended me permanently. I got an email saying that I was suspended for operating fake accounts. This account will not be reinstated. This comes on the heels of our extraordinary exposed CNN series. All of those videos are now taken down. This is not a coincidence.
What do you think, James?
I think I know it, but like the guy who won Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, let's call that.
Okay. He is the president and CEO of something called Project Veritas.
Yes, exactly who I thought. Hey, Dad, I just won a book by Larry Elder. It's James O'Keefe.
Somebody give me an amen.
Woo! Well done.
trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
You hear a lot of people talk about end of days and whether we are preparing for the raptures. They can be easily forgiven because of all that is happening in our life. This country alone, don't look to the world, but to this country alone, we are watching the American heritage turned upside down. We're watching illegal immigrants given money by a government that denies it to those who are hardworking Americans with families to support. We are looking at a president who wouldn't answer a question, as I said, about packing the Supreme Court. But today, he's creating a commission and doing full everything in his power to move toward another four justices that will dilute the court. It's just one thing after another. And one rational thing that he's done, which is to announce he's bringing home our troops from Afghanistan, that is what President Trump wanted to do years ago and was stymied at every turn by the military-industrial complex.
Yeah, we're not going to mention the neocons and Lindsey Graham because that would be inappropriate. Yeah. Have you been in touch at all? And you don't have to say if you, but I'm wondering if you've been in touch with the president at all.
I've talked to him a number of times here. I guess most recently a week or so ago. And he, by the way, sounds great. He is sounds rested and he's obviously taking on issues every day.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Man. Joe Manchin, Senator Joe, did a tele-town hall yesterday about West Virginians and why they vote Republicans. Listen to this, Cut 18.
People asked me one time, they said, what happened to West Virginia? How come West Virginia's changed from a Democrat state to a Republican state? How did that happen in the quickest amount of time that we've ever seen? I said, I can tell you how West Virginia feels. We feel like the returning Vietnam veteran. We've done every dirty job you've asked us to do. We never questioned. We did it and performed well. And now all of a sudden, we're not good enough. We're not clean enough. We're not green enough. We're not smart enough. You want to know why they quit voting for Democrats? That's the reason.
That's exactly. The entire country knows that a handful of elite Democrats think they're morons.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today.
So I think that the biggest issue with Democrats is that they're so focused on what's happened in the past, they're not looking to the future to try to move forward. It's the whole victim-victor mindset. Victims look at the past and what they've been through, and victors look at the future and what's ahead of them and how to make it better.
I believe that it stems from the history of this country. It stems from slavery, when whites were absolutely in charge and they absolutely controlled the lives of people and their families. If they decided to separate families and send the boys in one direction, the girls in another direction, the mothers to the big house, I mean, they've always been in charge. And I think that this thinking about the need to control, the need to, you know, make sure that people stay in their place, so-called, has been, you know, what has been basically what has happened in America for all of these years. And I think it continues in various ways, sometimes a little bit more sophisticated ways. But the police, I think, really believe and in some ways are led to believe that their greatest challenge and their greatest chore is to keep, you know, black people in their place.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. I am Larry Elder. We are ReliefFactor.com studio. There are roughly 800 sworn police officers in the country, and Maxine Waters said that she believes that you believe your job is to, quote, keep black people in their place, close quote. Wow. James won the contest. Phone a bro, James. Very well done. You nailed James O'Keefe.
Thank you very much.
You nailed James O'Keefe. That was really clever the way you pulled that off. Impressive.
I'll probably never get on that show, but
I enjoyed it. Thank you very much.
Well, James, very well played. And, of course, make sure we get your information, and the book is en route. Now, regarding the zip poll question I left you with, I ask you, if you were paying attention to the Chauvin trial, do you believe he'll be guilty of at least one of the three charges? 70% of you said yes, and you were right. Here's the one for tonight. We've got a double. Do you support granting statehood to Washington, D.C.? Do you support granting statehood to Puerto Rico? Yes or no? Yes or no? In order to participate, you must be a member of the Zip community. Go to your app store, download the Zip app by searching under Zip Poll USA, and be sure and use my code SAGE, S-A-G-E. And we'll go over the results on Monday. Kevin McCarthy, the House Republican leader, says that the Democrats could have condemned Maxine Waters. Instead, they condone her rhetoric. And Nancy Pelosi says, I'm not going to criticize her. There may be a move to try to have her censured, but don't hold your breath. Alan Dershowitz said Maxine Waters borrowed precisely from the Ku Klux Klan, and the judge should have granted a motion for a mistrial. So if and when this trial is overturned on appeal, Maxine Waters, look in the mirror. I'm Larry Elder. Everybody have an outstanding weekend. I'll see you on Monday. I will be checking attendance.